Welcome back to AI Red Teaming 101, the series where we teach you how to get started on your AI Red Teaming journey. I'm Dr. Amanda Minnich from the Microsoft AI Red Team. In the last episode, we introduced what AI Red Teaming is, how it differs from traditional security testing, and why generative AI systems require new approaches to safety and security. Today, we're going to dig into how generative models work and how their foundations shape both their capabilities and also their vulnerabilities. So most traditional AI systems were built to do specific tasks like classifying emails, recommending products, or identifying faces in photos. Generative AI is a bit different. These models don't specifically classify or score, they generate. They sample from learned distributions to produce new outputs based on patterns in their training data. And whether it's text, images, code, or audio, they generate responses by recombining these patterns in ways that fit the current prompt and context. Think of it like a supercharged autocomplete, but instead of finishing your sentence, it can write essays, generate legal memos, or produce working code. And this is partly because of how large and flexible these models are. GPT-3, for example, has 175 billion parameters, which are adjustable weights that capture patterns in language. For comparison, the human brain has about 86 billion neurons. These models aren't exactly thinking, but they operate at a scale that allows for surprisingly general behavior. And some models go even further. The multimodal models, like GPT-4o or Gemini, can handle not just text, but also images, audio, and video, all within the same model. And not all language models are large. Small language models, or SLMs, like the Phi series from Microsoft or Gemma from Google, are optimized to run on local devices and target more narrow tasks. They're much faster and cheaper to train, but they can be less robust when pushed beyond their training scope. But whether you're working with a compact model or one of the giants, they all rely on the same foundational training process. So how does a model learn to generate language at all? Let's walk through the key phases that turn massive data sets into something that can respond with relevance and fluency. So generative AI models go through multiple types of training. Unlike traditional machine learning models, which tend to have one training stage and then be ready to use, generative AI models require many different stages to get to the level of capability that they have. So pre-training is the first stage, and this is the one that takes many months and huge amounts of compute. The model learns general patterns from massive data sets, huge amounts of books, many, many websites, large repositories of code, and this is mostly unsupervised. So for a language model, you would feed some text in, and the model would predict what should come after that text, and then you compare the difference between what it predicted and what should actually come, and you update the parameters in the model based on that, and then you repeat this many, many times. This is what gives the model its broad capabilities, but it also means that any bias, misinformation, or harmful content that was in the original data set gets baked in. So the unsafe stuff goes in early. Post-training is the next stage. So here we want to turn the model from a general purpose language model into something that can respond and interact, answer questions, and follow instructions. And so we do this through a lot of supervised fine-tuning, where we train the top layers of the model. We also do our safety post-training here. So this is where we teach the model what to say and what not to say. And most of the behaviors that we associate with safe AI, like refusal to answer certain questions or avoiding certain topics, aren't built into the model from the start. They're layered on during this stage, which is why they can seem kind of brittle. Small changes in wording, tone, or context can cause them to break down. And then red teaming, which is what our team does, happens right before release. So this is where teams stress test the model to try to find areas where harmful content can still be emitted or the safety protocols of the model can break down. And it's part of a break-fix loop of model development. So we find issues, they get patched, and then we try again. And this is all just on the model side. There's, on the application side, developers often add their own layers of testing, guardrails, and mitigations. And we'll talk more about this in episode 7. But understanding where the risks come from in these models is the first step. So the way that these models interact with text is through tokenization. So what is a token? A token can be a chunk of text, sometimes a whole word, but often parts of words. It can also be punctuation, numbers, and emojis. The tokenizer itself is in charge of deciding how everything should be broken down. So here on the top of the slide, we have raw text, I love dogs, period, smiley face. And the tokenized text might look like I love dog, hash S to signify plural, period, smiley face. And so this is how the model starts to take in the data. And it's seeing this stream of tokens and trying to predict what comes next. And this is where things can get interesting, because if you understand how the model is reading in these tokens, you can start to manipulate them. And attackers, as well as AI red teamers, exploit the token stream to bypass filters, confuse classifiers, or sneak malicious content past guardrails. We'll dig more into those techniques in episode 5. But for now, keep in mind that the way language is chopped up can open the door to creative exploits. Each token then gets turned into a vector, which is a list of numbers that capture its meaning and how it relates to other tokens. These embeddings place similar concepts close together in the vector space. For example, here we see that cat and kitten are close together, and they're closer to puppy and dog than they are to bird, which is partway in between rain and sky. And so this is a two-dimensional space. Our embeddings are very high-dimensional, but the relationship between these vectors is how concepts get mapped. And what makes this really powerful is how these vectors get processed. The transformer architecture, which is used in every major generative model today, lets the model pay attention to different parts of the input at once. It picks up on dependencies across long stretches of text, and it allows us to track relationships that might span dozens or even hundreds of tokens. So the ability to model context across a full sequence is what allows generative models to produce coherent, useful outputs. And it's also what makes them vulnerable to attacks that tamper with that context. We'll go deeper into those risks in the next episode. Thanks for joining us to explore how generative AI models are built and why that foundation introduces unique security challenges. In the next episode, we'll dive into the core of the most common real-world attacks, prompt injection, what it is, how it works, and how to craft one yourself. For tools, labs, and more, head to aka.ms/AIRT101. See you next time.